In the wake of the death of Ruth Bader Ginsburg, I'd like to discuss briefly one of the assertions that she made that has been a problem for a long time. The notion that the Constitution of the United States of America is a so-called living document. The Constitution is not a living document, but to understand why, first we need to define living document. See, when I started arguing with people in the YouTube comments, something which no civilized person does, but I am not a civilized person, I found that there are two definitions of living document that people understand. One of those definitions is that a living document can be modified, as in amended. The Constitution definitely has 27 or so amendments, and you can amend it. In that regard, it is a, quote, living document, if that's your definition. But that's not what Ruth Bader Ginsburg meant when she said the Constitution is a living document. What Ruth Bader Ginsburg said meant that the Constitution is open to a loose interpretation rather than a strict one. Here's a prime example of that in action. The Second Amendment says, "The right to keep and bear arms shall not be infringed." The first part about a well-regulated militia, blah blah blah, is a purpose statement, but it doesn't actually affect the part of the law that executes an action. It's simply a statement of purpose. We need people to be armed to defend the country, therefore the government can't do anything to stop people from being armed. That's really all there is to it, because the first thing that a tyrant does is try to take your weapons away so that you can't resist them. The right to keep and bear arms shall not be infringed. It's plain, it's clear. If it were reworded today, it would say something like, people are allowed to own guns and carry them around, and the state can't do anything about it. Now, Ruth Bader Ginsburg and her living document nonsense would have us believe that this Second Amendment thing does not mean what the words plainly say on their face, but rather would have us assign subjective interpretations of those words that do not fall in line with a strict interpretation. For example, the right to keep and bear arms shall not be infringed. That's pretty difficult to do anything with, but that part before it, about a well-regulated militia. See, this is where you get ridiculous arguments like, well, militia only meant the military. Militia only meant people who were officers, whatever. Any of that kind of stuff is bull. The militia is the people. The militia has always been the people. The militia are not just the military, the police, the people who are in positions of authority, which, by the way, are granted by the government. Those positions are government-appointed or government-gate-kept positions. If a well-regulated militia being necessary for maintenance of a free state, I don't remember the precise wording, but there you go. We can argue, based on our living document, that a well-regulated militia means the military and the cops. You know, just because they meant militia was the people back then doesn't mean that militia means the people today. They're changing the meaning. Why would we want to do that? Gun control. So we can push unconstitutional gun control. In this regard, you can see that the Constitution is a living document really just means we want to be free to reinterpret the Constitution in the most flexible manner possible to push our agenda that probably violates the Constitution on its face. Gun control is the easiest example to drag out and beat to death with a stick. One of the things that people don't like about the notion of abolishing gun control, which is already against the top law of the land, is that it would allow everyone who wants one to have one, and it would not stop people from owning automatic weapons and such. Well, guess what? That's what the Constitution says, and hey, if you have a problem with that, and you don't think that people should be allowed to own weapons with a certain amount of killing capacity, guess what? It's a living document in that you can get it amended. But as it stands right now, the Constitution is not a living document in that you can reinterpret it as you please, but it is in that you can amend it. Ruth Bader Ginsburg was the pusher of the living document, as in loose interpretation. It is not meant to be interpreted loosely. The problem with Ruth Bader Ginsburg and her living document assertion is that it sparked decades of constitutional violations, because now that the Constitution is no longer a strict legal document like every other law in the land, we can play with it. We can get away with twisting the meaning of the words. We can choose how we frame what we read. In much the same way that the militia somehow pivoted from the people of the United States to military, police, and other authority figures appointed or gatekept by the government, other provisions of the Constitution follow suit. Free speech? What are your limitations on free speech? There is no way to have absolutist free speech because there are instances where what you say can harm someone, but they're very rare. The problem is the concept of hate speech doesn't exist in the Constitution, but a lot of people would like for it to. If the Constitution is a living document that we can loosely interpret, then the right to freedom of speech, freedom of the press, etc., they can have restrictions put on them because now the document doesn't mean what it says. It means what we choose to interpret it to say. So, Congress shall pass no law restricting the freedom of speech. Pretty straightforward. The Constitution says freedom of speech. End of story. But if we loosely interpret it, Congress shall make no law restricting the free speech, freedom of assembly, freedom of the press, and so on. Make no law doesn't mean make no law, right? It just means if you make a law, then it just has to, let's make some other rule sets that we'll call regulations. You know, we won't say that they're laws to restrict speech. They're laws to protect people. That's the problem, is that even if it has the act of restricting speech, they'll call it something else, but it'll still be a law that's unconstitutional. These people pass laws that break the highest law of the land that is very clear and plain in its language. And Ruth Bader Ginsburg is a huge force behind all of that for decades. So, in that regard, I'm glad she's dead, because she was a problem. She thought the Constitution wasn't the Constitution, but rather something that she could twist to her own agenda. And that's not okay in a Supreme Court justice. A Supreme Court justice's job is to enforce the law. They are the final arbiters of what is or is not a violation of the highest law of the land, the United States Constitution. And to have someone on that court who says, oh, well, the Constitution is a living document, so I'm going to reinterpret it to insert this, that, or the other agenda, regardless of what the agenda is, whether it's conservative, liberal, left, right, authoritarian, libertarian, regardless of the agenda being pushed, it's not okay. The Constitution is strictly interpreted, plainly worded, end of story. To do anything otherwise, to apply loose interpretation, is simply incorrect, but also, it's fascism. At the end of the day, we all play by a set of rules that we agree on. The Constitution is the top rulebook that guides all the other rules. If even the Constitution is open to subjective reinterpretation because it's a living document, then what rules are we really playing by here? If the Constitution is so flexible, if the rules have so much, I don't know, maybe we should read it to mean something a little different than what it actually says. If that's the case, then how can any of us play by the same rule book? I might choose one interpretation, you might choose another. And that's how you end up with all kinds of problems between people. Beyond legal actions, it can escalate into violence. Given the time I'm recording this, I think you can see that that's what's going on. Have a good one.